Chris Carter here on the Locked On Steelers podcast. Today, we answer all your NFL draft questions with a mailbag episode here on the Wednesday edition. Let's get into it.
You are Locked On Steelers, your daily Pittsburgh Steelers podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Hello, welcome to the Locked On Steelers podcast. I'm your host, Chris Carter, bringing you your daily dose of all things in the Pittsburgh Steelers. As always, you can find the show in your favorite podcasting apps and on YouTube. Like this video if you enjoy it. Subscribe to this YouTube channel to get all of your daily Monday through Friday episodes, as well as our bonus content. Thank you for making us your first listen every day, because we're your team every day. And today's episode is brought to you by Monopoly Go. I admit it, I have a competitive side, and as a big fan of Monopoly Go, it's a great way to get that competitive itch. The mobile hit twist on classic Monopoly. Join your friends and download Monopoly Go now free on the App Store or Google Play. All right, Steelers fans, let's get into it. As always, we appreciate everyone who's tuning into the show and checking things out. You know, sometimes we can't get to the mailbag, but I thought to myself, let's do a mailbag episode at least just once on the week of the draft. So we're going to answer, I think we got five questions of recent questions that people have called in for. We'll get into them. As always, if you want to call to get your question on the show, do so at 412-223-6644. Leave your name, where you're from, and keep your question under a minute, and we'll get your question answered on the show. That being said, let's get to our first question here. And our first question comes from Virginia. We got Mac, and this is sort of a relevant question to the draft and the most important position that I think the Steelers might address in the first round. That's offensive tackle, but also relative to their last year first round pick in Broderick Jones. Mac from Virginia, take it away.
What's going on, CC? This is Mac from Virginia. I'm actually the one that tweeted at you and told you to change the name to Tomlin Trifecta instead of Trinity. But, hey, I had a question, man. I see a lot of potential in Broderick Jones. I'd like to know, where do you think he would rank if he was coming out this year in this stacked offensive tackle draft? And then also, if you could sort of say, who are the guys that would be good enough on the left side or on the right side that Broderick would have to think on the right side if we got one of the ones on the left, or we'd be able to play left if we got one on the right?
Thank you very much for your question, Mac. So let's address this a few different ways. One, let's start back to where Broderick Jones ranked last year. And in just the order of players who were picked, it was Paris Johnson, then Darnell Wright, then Broderick Jones. And then, of course, there was Anton Harrison, Matthew Bergeron, Cody Moore. There was a bunch of guys that came after that. Anton Harrison was the late first round. There were four first round offensive tackles, but three went in the top 14. Broderick Jones was the last to do so. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that was the best, but that's just where they were drafted. If y'all remember, I was saying that Broderick Jones was my top offensive tackle last year, and I know that I even said, like, hey, I think other teams aren't going to see it that way, but just the way that these guys look, I think Broderick Jones is the guy that the Steelers should really want to get. They ended up getting him, and it worked out. So let's do this experiment real quick. Let's re-rank them. Let's re-rank Broderick Jones among this year's offensive tackles. And to do so, I'll pull up my top 100 board just to show things here. And we'll start with the top 32 players here, because that's really where I think you'd have to see where he fits in. So the first tackle I have listed here is Joe Alt. I think Joe Alt, you know, would have been also the best tackle last year. I think that he's a complete picture guy that everyone kind of agrees is, you know, the full thing that you want. I also think Olu Fashanu, if you compare it in both years, I think Olu Fashanu has the best overall tape of being a pass-protecting left tackle between all the tackles in the last 2 years. So I would take those two at the top of last year's list. But if I were to discount them and say, well, what about Broderick Jones? What about Broderick Jones fitting into this year's if I was to take Broderick Jones and slip in here, I think I'd put it right after Fashanu, just like we did last year with those three tackles. I think he would be the third best tackle of this class. I think that he would get drafted similarly around where I think where I have it ranked in the The power in my top 100 big board here. If you look closely, I got Troy Letanu. He's at 14, and that's right where on my big board here, and that's right where Broderick Jones got drafted. I think that that's where he would be. And honestly, I think in this class he would go even higher. I think like if I was to put him in this class, I'd put him right after Fashanu at 9 instead of Fuaga being at 9. So I think Broderick Jones has the potential to be a great pass protector and a great run blocker. I think he has he's young, he has the frame, he has the size, he has the athleticism, all the things. I think Broderick Jones would fit there. Now, as far as fitting with Broderick Jones, and I got kind of got confused a little bit what you were saying there, Mac, but I think I get what you were trying to get the point across is what would be the best fit for a tackle this year to make an elite pair with Broderick Jones on the left side or the right side? Because I agree with you. I think that Broderick Jones has the sky is the limit for him as a blocker in the Steelers offensive line. I think he's one of the biggest reasons that Steelers fans should be excited about the future of this offensive line, because I think that he can be a pillar for it moving forward. One of those anchor guys that we've been talking about the Steelers need on their offensive line. Goes to show when he became a full-time starter after that, that's when they started to become one of the best rushing offenses in the NFL. Again, in the last 10 games of the season, they had the second best rushing numbers of all teams in the NFL, only behind the Ravens. So who would you get here? To be honest, I think it just depends on what falls to the Steelers. You know, if somehow, like, there's some people that are downing Olu Fashanu or Fashanu out of Penn State because they're saying, oh, his hand size is small. Well, he's not as great of a run blocker as you'd want, but he's elite. You know what? If you got Fashanu in the first round and you put him at left tackle and Broderick at right, I think the Steelers would be very happy with that, because I think that you have a better pass protector in Fashanu, and then Broderick Jones can just be your mauler, which we've already seen him kind of be your mauler on the right side. But I also think that Broderick Jones could be a great left tackle. So you know what? If you ended up with Fuaga, who's basically a right tackle, I don't think that would be – that's the thing. I think Broderick Jones's athleticism and flexibility gives you the space to be able to – if you wanted to create an elite offensive tackle pair with this draft class, he is setting the foundation for you to say, hey, you know what? Because I have to think Fautanu, the tackle out of Washington, you know, some people want to move him to guard. I think he'd be another right tackle type player. You put him there, you put Broderick Jones at left, you're rocking out. You're doing great there. I think Mims is another right tackle guy, but both him and Broderick Jones had freakish builds that kind of allow you to kind of do that. I think that the Steelers would be open to being flexible there. And I think Broderick Jones should be open to being flexible there. I know that, you know, contractually, he probably wants to be a left tackle because left tackles are the tackles that get paid the most traditionally in the NFL. But if I'm the Steelers, I'm seeing an opportunity to get a potential elite offensive tackle, whether it's right or left, I do not care what side it is on. Get a tackle who is dominant. If one of those top six follow you, you scoop them up and then you figure it out after that. You say, you know what? Let's look at their tape. Let's test these guys out. Who's more comfortable on the right? Who's more comfortable on the left? Who's a better anchor? Like, who's the best overall player? Which one has the best chance to become the best overall offensive lineman on our team if we give them the left or the right side? And then go from there and build that way. But that's how I think the Steelers should play into it. They shouldn't limit themselves. And again, if Broderick Jones is in this draft class, I still think he'd be at worst the third best tackle of the class, and a guy that would probably be looking to go in the early teens, if not earlier, because of the tackle class this year. But yeah, so in a great tackle class, I still rank Broderick Jones compared to this year very high. And if you get another great player from this great tackle class, I think it sets you up with a potential elite offensive line for years to come. So great question there, Mac. We'll get to other questions here. We have more coming your way on the Locked On Steelers podcast. I'm your host, Chris Carter. Stick with us to see if your question gets answered right here on the Locked On Steelers podcast. But first, I want to remind you, this show is brought to you by eBay Motors. Passion, drive, and patience, that's what brings home the winning trophy. And it's also what keeps your ride or die alive. eBay Motors has everything you need to maintain your vehicle and level it up to peak performance. From superchargers to roof racks, exhaust kits, LED headlights, and more, whether you're into speed, power, or style, eBay Motors has got you covered. With over 122 million parts for your number one ride or die, you'll always find exactly what you're looking for. And with eBay's Guaranteed Fit, your part is guaranteed to fit your ride every time or your money back. Because with eBay Motors, you're burning rubber, not cash. With all the parts you need at the prices you want, it's easy to turn your car into the MVP and bring home that win. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply. eBay's Guaranteed Fit only available to U.S. customers. Back here on the Locked On Steelers podcast, I'm your host, Chris Carter. Let's continue our mailbag episode where we answer your questions. Again, call in 412-223-6644. Leave your name, where you're from, and keep your question under a minute, and we'll get your question answered here on the show, featuring your question here. We move now forward to G, who asks us a question about a position that maybe we aren't talking enough about. Take it away, G.
What's going on, man? This is G. I would say that my question would be, are we downplaying the need to upgrade our defensive line? And I follow that up with this. Chris Jones was the reason the Chiefs lost their first game, and Chris Jones was the reason they won the Super Bowl.
Thank you for the question, Dean. I think it's a good one. I think it's a good point. Again, 412-223-6644 to get your question on the air here on the Locked On Steelers podcast. But to answer G's question here, the first part of it, no, I don't think I'm overlooking it. Maybe some people are. I think that maybe we're talking about other positions, you know, as taking priority over defensive line. But I'm not mistaking the need to get a young defensive lineman. In fact, that's kind of one of my points about why the Steelers should not trade away draft picks this year. Because if the opportunity comes to get a defensive lineman, like, say, Braden Fisk from Florida State falls to you in the second round, you sprint to the podium, you grab that guy, and then you say, okay, how are we going to get these other guys here? These third-round picks got to come in handy somehow. But I think the problem is that the Steelers have so many other needs. One thing that the Steelers have going for them, yes, Cam Hayward's old, and yes, Larry Ogunjobi didn't play too great last year. But I think Keanu Benton is a true future star of the defensive line. I think that he is a stalwart guy that's going to be there for quite some time and a person that you want on your defensive front for years to come. So with that, knowing that you have a young guy there who is a big piece that you think you can build around, I think the defensive line can wait a little bit. Like, look, if Byron Murphy falls to 20, which I don't think he will, that's a very interesting idea to be able to get a guy like that who could be great, could become a great elite interior pass rusher next to Keanu Benton, and then that could lock that up. But here's the thing. If your offensive line isn't fixed going into next year, you're asking a lot of the same questions you've had the last few years. And I think that's why the Steelers, this is the year to fix the offensive line. Go get the tackle, go get the center, and say, all right, this group is solidified for years to come. Then next year, we see about what's going on at quarterback. I think you can look at that defensive line class and see how things are going. But if there is a chance in the second, third, fourth, or fifth round to get a defensive lineman who you think will be a good addition to the team, and we've talked about some of them. I even showed some of them in the photo that I put together that had for G's call. You know, I really like Braden Fisk out of Florida State. I think Rook Ororo out of Clemson's another great one. Chris Jenkins out of Michigan. And if you want to wait even further, Mason Smith out of LSU, I think would be an amazing fit for the Steelers if he was to fall to the third round. But again, I'm not overlooking it. I just think that there's other priorities. Now to your point about Chris Jones, I do agree. It is very important to have a guy because when you have a player that can make a difference in the middle, it can win games. I mean, you can also point back to Aaron Donald and what he did for the Los Angeles Rams. But let's also put that into perspective a little bit. Those two guys are the best interior pass rushers in the NFL. Those are two guys that you're going to have to that you're not just going to pick that guy up every year in the draft. That guy doesn't exist every year, you know? Aaron Donald, I think, was the 13th overall pick in the year that he was selected. You know, he was a high first-round pick, a guy that everyone kind of looked at. Now, Chris Jones was a second-round pick, so you can say, like, well, they got him there. Sure, but, you know, there aren't Chris Jones that just grow on trees every year. That's not just something that's going to happen all the time. Doesn't mean that they shouldn't take a shot at it, but I also think it should be like, hey, you know, those things won it, but you know what? You could say all the time, like, you know what, you know, maybe 1 year, you know, the quarterback position, you could say that, but the quarterback position almost every single year, some years it's a cornerback who makes a big difference. Some years it's an edge rusher that makes a big difference. If you go to different years, you know, for the Steelers, there were years where Troy Polamalu was the big difference. Should you get a safety? I just think that, you know, you don't want to get stuck on just one reason to draft a position. So I think you can get a little lost doing that, but that does not dismiss your point, G. You make a very good point that the Steelers are old at this position. And when you think about what makes the great Steelers defenses, you think about defensive fronts. You think about the steel curtain. You think about Casey Hampton in the 2000s. You even think about recently with Cam Hayward. He was a big part of what allowed them to emerge with Cam Hayward and Stephon Tuitt. When they were healthy as a 1-2 punch, that was a deadly defensive line. And don't get me started on Javon Hargrave. So I do think defensive line needs to be on their radar, but I also think it is on their radar. It's just that these are other positions of need that I think speak a little bit louder. If they don't have a center going to next season, big problems. If they can come away with a super offensive tackle to pair with Broderick Jones, like we talked about in the last segment, this offensive and get a center, that could be one of the best offensive lines for years to come. And that could be something, a position that you don't have to address for many years now. The same way the Steelers kind of ignored the offensive line after they drafted Pouncey, DeCastro, and Gilbert in those early years. And that's kind of allowed them to focus on getting a Bud Dupree event, getting a TJ Watt, getting, loading up other parts of the team. So that being said, I don't think anyone's looking over downplaying defensive line. I just think that it's that there's other needs and also this isn't this year's defensive line class isn't what the wide receiver class is, nor is it what the offensive tackle class is. So I think that plays into that conversation. Certainly. Let's get into a question from Ryan from Kansas City, who kind of asked a question that we've addressed a few times here, and it's about a trade that everyone's wondering, will the Steelers make it? Here's Ryan.
Hey, Chris, this is Ryan in Kansas City. I love the show. My question is about your take on the reality of the Steelers' current needs and desires. Specifically, I'm talking about Brandon Ayuk. You know, I started thinking about how close we really are to a Super Bowl, and man, we're there. We're on the doorstep. So given that we already have George Pickens as a true number one, in my opinion, on the roster, do we really want to spend that draft capital to get somebody like a Brandon Ayuk? I mean, we're likely looking at giving up, a second-round pick and then some. And that's not even to mention the cap hit. Personally, I'm passing on Ayuk unless it's incredibly favorable for us. In your opinion, is it possible that there's a scenario where we can get Ayuk and not completely torpedo our draft needs at, O-line, cornerback, and yes, we do need a wide receiver, but this draft class is pretty dang deep, right? Anyway, thanks for your thoughts. Thanks for your work. Here we go.
Thanks for your question, Ryan. Appreciate the question. As always, 412-223-6644 to get your question on the air here on the Locked On Steelers podcast. But Ryan, great points brought up here because clearly you watch the show, because these are things that I've been saying for weeks here on the Locked On Steelers podcast. Well, if there's some people out there that think, oh, Brandon Ayuk, go get him. You got to get him. Got to get him. There's no other way. There's no now. Do it now. And I'm just like, relax. Because some people were saying the same thing about Justin Fields months ago. Do it now. First rounder. It's easy right there. Second rounder. Sixth rounder. Now, I'm not saying you're going to get Brandon Ayuk for a sixth rounder. That's not what's going to happen. But what about the possibility that the Niners are like, look, we can't afford Brandon Ayuk. We need to do something here. And they really like, Brian Thomas Jr., Adonai Mitchell. But they're scared that those guys aren't going to fall to 31. So then you think to yourself, all right, we'll take Brandon Ayuk off your hands as you're thinking this is the Steelers, but we're not going to give up a pick. Instead, we'll swap picks. And instead, what if you jump up 11 picks so you can get your receiver of the future, and then we'll move down to 31. And then when you're at 31, that's prime draft a center range. That's where I think if there's a move for Brandon Ayuk, again, I'm not for it. I think that stay at 20, get a great tackle or a great corner or, whoever you want there. Graham Barton, if he's the only other guy left. Like, I think 20 is a great place to draft this year. But if you really want Brandon Ayuk, that's the way to get him. Don't give up a pick. Trade down. And in trading down, then you could say, all right, sure, we're going to be paying some money to Brandon Ayuk, but we're getting the center. in the first round. And then you can still get wide receiver in the second and third round. And then your receiving core is Pickens, Ayuk, and the rookie. That I can make sense with. But you cannot give away a draft pick. And again, we were just talking about how the Steelers have so many needs: tackle, corner, wide receiver, center. And then, you know, as G pointed out, defensive line is still important. I still think linebacker would be nice to address. They still need not just an outside corner, but a slot corner for this upcoming season. And we'll get into other late round needs with another question that's coming up in the third segment here. But that's why if there is a Brandon Ayuk trade, it is not to give away a pick. It is to at worst swap positions, move down in a round. And who knows? Omar Khan's been very savvy, man. He literally flipped around Kenny Pickett and Chase Claypool with the Bears for Justin Fields and Joey Porter Jr. Oh, excuse me, Kenny Pickett, Chase Claypool, at a sixth rounder for Justin Fields and Joey Porter Jr. I think, and certainly you can say there's other questionable trades. I wasn't a big fan of the Deontay Johnson, Dante Jackson trade. I was kind of like, yeah, I ain't feeling that so much. But I think it's clear Omar Khan has a plan, and he has shown in just 1 year's time that he has, there's some savvy to him. There's a plan there. Let him work. Let him develop the same way the Steelers let Kevin Colbert develop in the early 2000s. Because as much as people want to trash his last few drafts here in Pittsburgh, Kevin Colbert is a future Hall of Fame GM because he went and got Roethlisberger and Casey Hampton and Troy Polamalu, and he assembled two Super Bowl teams for the most part. So. All that to say, I'm with you. I wouldn't make the Ayuk trade if it's even giving away a pick. But moving down, maybe that's the one time I can stomach it. But we'll see how things continue to play out. I want to talk about other draft strategies that some of you had great questions on here on the Locked On Steelers podcast. We'll get back to your mailbag questions right after this. But first, I want to remind you that this show is also brought to you by Monopoly Go. I've been told I'm a competitive person, and well, that all stems back to my early days playing game nights with my family. And growing up, we had all sorts of different games we played, but the Super Bowl in our family was always Monopoly. It was always the game that you played at the end of the night, and then whoever won that, it was like you had a championship belt over your shoulder all on, around the house all week, talking all sorts of trash. Now, I carry that championship belt, and I'll talk all sorts of trash when I play Monopoly Go. It's the new mobile game that you can download right on your phone, and over 150 million times this app has been downloaded onto phones. It's a new twist on Monopoly where you can play on hundreds of different Monopoly boards in crazy locations, build up your own cities, and bring in big money. Best part, I can still beat my family and my friends and talk all that sort of trash. I can charge them rent for iconic Monopoly properties like Boardwalk and Park Place, or I can put a heist on their vaults to raid their vaults and raise my money up so I can get higher up on the Monopoly leaderboards. Get in the game and join your friends. Download Monopoly Go today, now free on the App Store or on Google Play. Back here in the Locked On Steelers podcast, I'm your host, Chris Carter. We continue answering your questions here on a mailbag episode here on Wednesday, the day before the draft. I'm excited. But let's get to your questions here. We have Logan from Charlotte, who asked an interesting question about addressing the center position. Take it away, Logan.
Hey, Chris. Logan Hartle here from Charlotte. Hey, man. Big fan of the show. Great work. Anyways, giving you a shout about the Steelers draft, first round. What are your thoughts on them taking a guy like Graham Barton or Troy Sitanu, not to play as tackle or center, but to play as guard? And hear me out here. What if they were to do something like that and then take Zach Frazier type of guy in the second round, and then your left side of your line would look like Broderick Jones, Graham Barton, Zach Frazier? Just seems like something that, you know, I know we want right tackle, but man, that just seems like it'd be a pretty dynamic left side of the line for years to come. So anyways, love the show. Really excited about the draft and everything you do surrounding the draft. So thanks and keep up the good work.
Thank you, Logan, for your question. As always, you can call in 412-223-6644. Leave your name, your question, and keep your question. Leave your name, where you're from, and keep your question under a minute. We'll get your question on the show, just like we did for Logan here out of Charlotte. Steeler Nation is everywhere, by the way. A reminder, we've had Kansas City, we've had Virginia, we've had Charlotte, we've had a Pittsburgh question. We also will be going out to the West Coast for our last question, so stay tuned for that. But let's get to Logan's question here about center. I hear what you're doing here. I hear what you're cooking up, Logan. Here's my only problem with this. Guard isn't a need necessarily right now for this team. Isaac Seumalo is at least here for two more years, and I think he's playing very well. James Daniels is on the last year of his contract, but he's young. I think that he's a guy that you signed to keep around. He's been playing very well. I think if you double down on interior offensive linemen, you're forcing one of those guys off your team before you really need to. And you're passing up on an opportunity to address another prime position in this draft class. And that's why, you know, we've kind of all been hesitant on maybe not center at 20, because tackle and corner, you know, there are two great positions that would be great for value there that can be long-term answers for you on the team. That's why I just think that the situation right now doesn't call for, you know, it calls for getting one center. Now, I think a different way to address this would be, let's say the Steelers get Graham Barton. Let's say the Steelers get Graham Barton, but you want to move Graham Barton around. He's more flexible. Maybe he's not the long-term answer. And then you go get a later center like Bo Limmer or Tanner Bordellini out of Wisconsin or Hunter Norris out of Penn State. And I've done this in a few mocks, and some people have been saying, why would you take two centers in your mocks? Because I'm like, look, buddy, I'm not saying that you're going to start two centers, but I'm preparing for the chance here that one of these guys go down. Because let's face it, Nate Herbig, again, I know that the Steelers are saying, oh, we believe in Nate Herbig and things like that. Why, if you believed in him, why didn't he ever go in? Because Mason Cole was having some really rough games, as you saw with our Stars and Skulls grades multiple times last season when we grade players after games, and Mason Cole was woof. But they did not put Nate Herbig in once. And so, to me, getting a starter and a backup in this draft would make sense if you can get it in the, if you can get one in the second round and maybe one in like the fifth round or maybe one in like the sixth round. I don't think they have a seven round pick, but if they could get a steal like that, that would be enticing to me. But I do not think the answer is drafting a guy to play guard. I think that the answer is getting a center for sure in this draft class. But if you're getting a second offensive lineman, getting the other tackles so that Dan Moore Jr. can be more of a swing guy. You know, he's on the last year of his deal, or, you know, he can just move off the team entirely after this year if you deem that to be the better move. But I just don't think the answer is getting a guard, a position that you're actually kind of strong at right now, and then a center. So I appreciate the strategy and the idea there, Logan. I just don't think that's the way to do it. But certainly, if they got Barton or Frazier at all, that solves the question, in my opinion. Those guys are starting centers right away, and the Steelers are one step closer to having that offensive lineman there. Let's get to our last question of the show here. And this one I saved for last because I thought it was really interesting, and it's a question that we don't get to talk a lot about because we talk a lot about the early needs in the draft. But Scott from Los Angeles has a question about later needs. Take it away, Scott.
Hey, Chris. This is Scott Lenz calling from Los Angeles. Love the show. My question for you is, we're getting closer and closer to the draft here, is what position do you hope the Steelers, like, make a point of drafting a guy, maybe in the later rounds, a position that might not be a huge need for us, but a spot you'd want to see some investment from the team, like a running back or a tight end? I mean, probably not a tight end since we brought in Michael Pruitt and a couple other guys this offseason, but, you know, maybe a position we're not thinking about that might need some attention in the later rounds, take a flyer on a guy with athletic traits or something like that. Appreciate you taking my question. Thanks.
Great question there, Scott. You know, again, 412-223-6644 to get your question on the show. I agree. Tight end ain't it. It ain't, that ain't a position. Not only Michael Pruitt, but don't forget that Roddy Williams guy who was very fantastic in training camp. I think he's still on the roster, at least I believe at this point. But either way, tight end, they're good there. However, you bring up an interesting point at running back, because while this year I think they're stacked, they got Najee Harris, Jalen Warren, and Cordarrelle Patterson can also play running back. But Cordarrelle Patterson's in his early to mid-30s. Who knows how much longer he's going to be effective? Wouldn't it be nice to have a running back waiting in the wings to become a third option if you keep Najee Harris for the long term, or a second option to be your future guy to pair with Jalen Warren? Whoever, I think it would behoove them to at least take a look at some of those players. And just to give you an idea, again, I'm going to admit to you, I ain't studied running back this year. I ain't looking at no running back tape. If the running backs that I know of are just guys that I saw because they played in big games this year, you know, Blake Corum out of Michigan, Trey Benson out of Florida State, Jonathan Brooks out of Texas. But guess what? Those are early running backs. The Steelers are not drafting any early running backs this year. Instead, I went back and I looked at just the overall profiles of some players that I think could be interesting fits. I think Will Shipley out of Clemson is an interesting name that could behoove the Steelers to add to their roster. Granted, I think Will Shipley, you're most likely drafting in the fourth or fifth round at the lowest. He might go third round. I don't know. Again, I haven't studied running backs like that, and I know that they were at his pro day. But one player that really intrigues me, who I think could be worth a serious look if he's there in the really late rounds, and I'm talking fourth, fifth, maybe even that sixth round pick at 195. Isaac Guarendo out of Louisville. Now, you probably like, who the heck is Isaac Guarendo? Well, let me tell you. Isaac Guarendo is a 6 foot, 221 pounds, so he's big, he's thick, running back who ran a 4.33 in the 40-yard dash. He is big, he is fast, and not just straight line fast. He has a great vertical, he has a great broad jump, he has a great shuttle time, and a great three cone. He just doesn't have a great profile in college to go along with it, so he's not going to be a higher up running back. You know what, though? If that guy's sitting there in the sixth round, get a great athlete. Because at worst, with that kind of speed, he's a kick returner, right? You work with him. He's a special teamer. You figure it out. You keep on a rookie deal for 4 years. If it don't work out, oh, well, you spent a late round pick on a running back that didn't work out. There's worse things that have happened. But I think that would be a smart move to play there. If you wanted to go at running back, just the Steelers, get an athlete. Get a guy that could be a difference maker. The idea the Steelers had with Dree Archer when they got him. Dree Archer was supposed to be a home run hitter that was going to pair with Le'Veon Bell, and they were going to be thunder and lightning, and Dree Archer just stunk, so that didn't work out. So I'm thinking something along those lines. And again, if you got a Guendo, they're not taking the place of Jalen Warren or Najee Harris this year, but they could be someone waiting in the wings. They could help you in other facets. I think that's where you go there. But as you saw, if you looked at the graphic, if you're watching on YouTube, sorry to those who are listening on audio, but I'll explain. If you looked at the graphic, I always do graphics with each of my call-ins, so I have their name on screen, but I also have images of players to give you an idea of who I'm going to talk about to kind of set the stage, if you will. And while I had Will Shipley and Isaac Guarendo on the screen on the right side, I had two receivers on the screen on the left side, and that's Luke McCaffrey and Bub Means. Now, these are just two of the later round receivers I think the Steelers should take a look at, and the Steelers have taken a look at it. Luke McCaffrey, in fact, I believe he was actually a top 30 visit for the Steelers. Hello, that's someone to take a look at there. Bub Means, if you don't know who Bub Means is, he was a Pitt wide receiver. You know, some people probably think like, oh, Pitt, not again, because some people don't like Pitt because of Kenny Pickett. Get over yourselves. There's a lot of great Pitt players out there. Aaron Donald just retired. He's one of the best defenders of all time. Again, get over yourself. But Bub Means, I covered Bub Means at Pitt the last 2 years of his collegiate career. Never had supreme numbers, but man, did Bub show a lot of talent and promise. The problem was he got there after Kenny Pickett, whereas Kenny Pickett didn't work out for the Steelers. He was a great quarterback for the Pitt Panthers. And Keaton Slovis and Phil Jakovic, yeah, not so much. And that's who Bub Means had to work with. But when I was at the Combine, I think I brought this up a few times on the show, Bub Means was getting a lot of hype because Bub Means is 6'2", runs a great 40, is explosive, and he's thick. He's strong. He's built. He can return kicks. He can return punts. He can be your gunner on special teams, and he can go up and get the football. Now, he has to be a more polished route runner, and there's other things to cook up in his game, but I was talking to scouts and people that worked for organizations at the Combine, and they were like, you covered Bub Means? That guy's for real. And I was like, whoa. I didn't think anyone else liked Bub like that. I think Bub's pretty good because I covered him. But when I saw that, I was like, okay, that's interesting. And then You know, your boy, Chris, I do my research. I listen to other experts that I respect. And one podcast I listened to is First Draft of ESPN. Shout out to those guys. They do a great job. But, man, if you've been paying attention to what Mel Kiper's been saying, and Mel Kiper's not always right. He certainly has his mess ups, just like we all do. There's times I'm way off about a guy. But Mel Kiper, I have counted at least three times in this offseason. He has said that Bob Means. Oh, that Bob Means. He could go. He's my guy. He's my sleeper. Field, you're gonna pass up on him. You're gonna make a mistake, and I'm going to take him, and he's going to be fantastic. I don't know if that was a great Mel Kiper. I think it was pretty decent, but I listened to him enough. So, anyways, I think Bob Means is one of those sleeper guys. I don't think Luke McCaffrey is one of those sleeper guys. And I I go back to the last time the Steelers cast off, well, I guess not the last time because they've cast off several good receivers, but another time the Steelers cast off a really great route runner who everyone was like, why did you get rid of this guy? And how they responded. And I think back to 2010 when they traded away Santonio Holmes because he just couldn't get his act together in Pittsburgh. And he was the Super Bowl 43 MVP and everyone's wondering, like, what the heck are they doing that for? And do you remember how they responded that next draft? They doubled down at wide receiver. They got one in the third and one in the sixth. Do you remember who those people were? The third round pick was a guy by the name of Emmanuel Sanders, who had a decent time with the Steelers, went on to become a Super Bowl champion, had some great years in the NFL for the Steelers and the Broncos. But then the sixth round guy was Antonio Brown. And that completed a receiving room that at that point had Hines Ward, who was aged, but they had Hines Ward, Mike Wallace, who was killing everybody with his speed, and then Sanders and Brown. And I know wide receiver is a position of need, and that's kind of, you know, Scott was talking about positions that not everyone's talking about, like running back. But in multiple mock drafts, I have had the Steelers taking two receivers in this draft class, because I think it back to that same year when I've been sitting there and I've been saying, I feel like with the trading away of Deontay Johnson, it is worth to try to double down at wide receiver to give yourself two chances. Because here's the other thing. Calvin Austin could work out and great. If he does, awesome. But I think you need to give yourself as many chances to hit at wide receiver right now as you can. Without going overboard, of course, still, you know, get your tackles, your corners, your everything else, your centers and all that. But if you can find a way to squeeze in two receivers in this draft class and you hit on one of them, and I mean hit, not like, you know, just a guy who's good for a couple years. I mean a guy that's going to be a problem for you in the future. You have now answered your problems. You can pair that guy with George Pickens, and that guy, it could be the late round guy, it could be the earlier round guy. But double down at wide receiver, I think that's a good plan. Maybe get a guy like Malachi Corley in the early rounds, and then maybe get like Bub Means in the later rounds. Luke McCaffrey's a smaller guy. So maybe if you wanted to get a bigger wide receiver, a guy who's a bit taller that can kind of play like George Pickens and then get Luke McCaffrey later, maybe that's another option. Because then at that point, you then have two big receivers and two small receivers, and Luke McCaffrey and Calvin Austin. And then, I don't know, we'll say Brian Thomas and George Pickens. I don't think they're getting Brian Thomas, even though they did talk to him. They have interest there. But point being, I do think that wide receiver is one of those positions that they should be open to and will be open to in the later rounds, as they should running back, as they should cornerback, as you should with all positions, really in the later rounds. You know, it is a game of darts that you play even in the early rounds of the NFL draft. Now, you have the early rounds, you have a bigger board that you can hit the numbers a lot easier with, right? Anyone who's played darts knows what I'm talking about. You know, it's not the, you're playing on the easier board that does that on the backside. When you go to the board, you flip it around. If you're using one of those electronic ones that are in common bars, and then it's the, all of a sudden the board's a lot smaller. That's the board that you're playing with, a smaller board with smaller areas to hit. And it's made for professionals. That's the board that you're playing with in the, really after the third round, because even fourth round picks are not promised things. Even third round picks aren't promised things. First round picks really aren't promised, but that's where your best educated guesses need to come in consistently if you're going to be a good front office. But in the late rounds, take some shots at playmakers, take some shots at great athletes. And if you miss, oh well. But take good calculated shots and take their athleticism into consideration. I think that will carry you along. We're way over time in our show, but hey, wanted to address as many questions as I could on the air here on the Locked On Steelers podcast. I'm your host, Chris Carter. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Carter Critiques. Read my work at the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, post-gazette.com. Find me here on the Locked On Steelers podcast every day, Monday through Friday, here on your favorite podcasting apps and on YouTube. Back tomorrow, we've got Jenna Harner. She'll be back on the show. It's been a while we've had her. She's been really busy doing life things and doing work. We're going to have her on to preview the NFL draft. We'll have our first round mocks, all the things to get you ready on Thursday. See you here on the Locked On Steelers podcast.